Good morning, everyone. We are continuing a further lecture in this embryology lecture series. Here you can see the today's topic in this sequence is the development of placenta. So mostly today we will focus on this placenta. We are going to repeat it. In short, what we have seen in the previous lectures. So in introduction, we'll see that ovum is released by ovulation. So in the last lectures, we have seen by ovulation, the ovum is released. Release ovum travel through uterine tube towards uterine cavity. Fertilization takes place at ampulla of uterine tube. This is a common site of fertilization. Then due to that, as effects we have seen, cleavage starts. Then morula stage, which is 16 cell stage, will come. By that time, embryo reaches to the uterine cavity. Morula, then blastocyst, still covered by zona pellucida. Even we have seen the functions of zona pellucida. Zona pellucida avoids abnormal sticking of embryo anywhere. Blastocyst also covered by trophoblast layer below zona pellucida. Trophoblast layer is sticky in nature. That we have seen in previous lecture. Zona pellucida will disappear when blastocyst reaches to the posterior superior wall of the fundus of uterus, which is a common site of the implantation. Here, this is a blastocyst. This is the epithelium in the uterus. These are uterine glands. If they are going inside and they're forming this uterine glands. And this is connective tissue, or we can say stroma. So this blastocyst comes here, and this trophoblast, which is outermost layer, which is sticky, it sticks to this when it comes. When the zona pellucida disappears, when it comes here at a proper site, then that zona pellucida will disappear, blastocyst will attach here or stick there. Then slowly implantation takes place and it gets buried into this endometrium. As already we all know that uterus has three layers: endometrium, which is innermost, myometrium, which is the middle, and perimetrium, which is the outermost layer. So uterus is made up of these three layers. Only endometrium is in touch with developing embryo. Implantation takes place in endometrium layer. So in the innermost layer, implantation takes place. Next need is to develop placenta. So this is the today's topic we'll focus, because in further series of the development of the embryo, this is the most needed part to develop the placenta, which provides a further need of the developing embryo, most of the nutrition, which is a source of nutrition to the developing embryo. Before that, we'll see two definitions. The implantation, the process by which blastocyst gets stick to the endometrium, is called implantation. And zona pellucida, they disappear, trophoblast layer exposed and gets stick to the uterine endometrium. It begins on the sixth stage of the fertilization. So this process in which blastocyst gets stick at a proper site, that is posterior superior part of the fundus of uterus, is called as implantation. In human being, it is an interstitial type of implantation. Means what does it mean? After sticking, blastocyst get burrows deeper and deeper in the full thickness of wall of the endometrium. So it is getting buried down in the complete thickness of endometrium. And that is called an interstitial type of implantation. And this is taking place in human being. With the help of diagram, we can see all this, we can explain all this. So this is a blastocyst. Here you can see the outermost layer of the trophoblast. This is the endometrium part here, which is an epithelium here. And this is a connective tissue or decidua, also called a stroma. Now, when it gets stick, now when zona pellucida disappear, being a sticky nature of this trophoblast, so it sticks to this part, then it eats or it get it destroys this epithelium lining of the endometrium of the uterus, then it goes slowly inside. Here you can see some part get disturbed and it is going slowly inside. When it is going inside, so outermost layer, outer side, it is covered by fibrin deposit. Then this trophoblast is going inside. Now after this, when it is buried down, interstitial type here, think it's going down. So it is burning down here as a inside the protoplast. Layer is getting formed here. So fibrin is formed here, outermost covering. Then this protoplast is called as cytoprotoplast. And here you can see one change. The stroma or residue one is converting to another type of cell we call here syncytoprotoplast. So coming from diagram A to B, here it is slowly going inside. Diagram C, this protoplast get converted into the cytoprotoplast, and at the same time you get here formation of syncytoprotoplast. Coming to the diagram D, here one more change you can see. This epithelium get covered from outside. The joints, this end joins with this end. So you can see completely the blastocyst is going inside. So it is interstitial type of implantation is here. So uterine epithelium is reformed here and continue rejoins with each other and forms a complete continuous epithelium here, lining epithelium. And this the blastocyst goes inside. By that time, changes occurs here to form the placenta. So in the diagram, you can see this is embryonic disc. This is embryonic cavity. Then you can see this is the rest of the part of the endometrium, what we call a residue. And this pink color, it is formation of syncytoprotoplast. Means at this stage, we have this is a cytoprotoplast, which is a converted later on. This protoplast later on we call as a cytoprotoplast. Then towards the uterine side, towards the endometrial side, syncytoprotoplast it forms. So at this end in the diagram B, what we can see, we can notice that the change is epithelium is reformed, continuous epithelium is formed outside, blastocyst going inside completely, that is interstitial type of implantation. And then this cytoprotoplast get formed, right, which get converting from protoblast, and syncytoprotoplast getting formed toward the residue. So what is residue? Already we have seen after the implantation of embryo, the uterine endometrium is called as residue. So this is another one change we have to notify. During implantation, endometrium is in a secretory phase. It is maintained further. So that secretory phase maintained the endometrium. Then decidual reaction will occur. What is the decidual reaction? Stromosis enlarges and store glycogen liquid called as decidual reaction. By this reaction, decidual get divided into the three parts. One is called as decidual basalis, another is called as decidual capsularis, and third is called as decidual parietalis. What do you mean by this decidual basalis? It is the endometrial stroma which we call decidua, it is deep to the developing blastocyst. That much part of decidua is called decidua basalis, which is deep to the developing blastocyst. Decidua capsularis, decidua separating the blastocyst from the uterine cavity is called as capsularis. And rest of it, the decidua parietalis. So decidua covering the rest of the part of the uterine cavity is called decidua parietalis. So decidua get divided in three part, one is basalis, one is capsularis, one is parietalis. During delivery, this decidua, placenta, and membranes get shed off. So they are removed naturally from the uterine cavity along with the baby. In this diagram, you can see this is a myometrium outer layer. This is a decidua basalis. So this is basically coming from here uterine cavity, implantation takes place. The blastocyst goes inside completely. When it goes inside, this decidua, right, the uterine endometrium, right. So after the implantation, we call decidua. It covers from this outer side here. So you get uterine cavity, then you get part of the decidua here, and then this developing embryo blastocyst is here. So naturally, this decidua after the decidual reaction divided in three parts. So one part is just deep to this developing embryo, which is called a decidua basalis. One which is covering here, right, towards the uterine cavity and covering this part of the developing embryo, we call decidua capsularis. It is like a capsule. And the rest of the part, right, This is uterine cavity. Rest of the part here beyond, which is called the basidium parietalis. So whole this, the uterine endometrium, let us call basidium, divided into three parts, deep to the tail of the embryo, then towards the uterine cavity, and this parietal, outermost part of this, the basidium. So basidium parietalis, basidium capsularis, basidium basalis. This is the site where the placenta will develop later on. Now here you can see in the further stage of development. So this is uterine cavity. Now you can see here this extraembryonic mesoderm, which divided right into the two parts by this extraembryonic cilium. So embryo reached up to this stage already we have seen. So this is extraembryonic cilium. This is the two part of the extraembryonic mesoderm. Somatopleuritic and splenomegaly part of extraembryonic mesoderm. This is endometrium, yolk sac, embryonic disc, amniotic cavity. This is unsplit part of extraembryonic mesoderm, what we call as connecting stalk. And this is a basidium basalis, where the placenta will form. Or this is the site where the placenta has to form. Then this extraembryonic cilium, and we have here the uterine cavity, uterine lumen. So there are various cavities within the uterus. So this is the cavity of the uterus, uterine lumen. This is the outermost cavity, right? Cilium in developing embryo. Extraembryonic cilium, and within that also you get yolk sac, again you get amniotic cavity. Later on in further stages we have seen intraembryonic cilium also get formed here somewhere when the intraembryonic mesoderm get formed. So intraembryonic cilium, then you get extraembryonic cilium, then you get uterine cavity. Meanwhile, the fetal membrane start to form. At the end of this lecture we are going to focus it on. So this is amnion and chorion. These are the two fetal membranes. As this embryo, later on fetus get expanded in the process of developing. So this membrane joins together, it comes here. It occupies this uterine cavity. Later on this amniotic cavity expands. And then it covers around the developing baby. So with all these cavities which are situated within each other. So we'll focus again at the end of this lecture. So we'll come to all this, compensate all these cavities with each other. Coming to the part of formation of this, the placenta, the most important first step is formation of chorionic villi. What in the villi here? Villi are very important part of the placenta. Villi are small finger-like process. General meaning of villi is like a small finger-like process. They are surrounded by maternal blood. In villi, fetal blood is circulating. Exchange between fetal and maternal blood takes place through the wall of villi, that is called as placenta barrier. So placental barrier. Again, we'll focus it in detail. But once this villi are formed, primary, secondary, and tertiary villi are formed, we will focus on the placental barrier. Now, chorion, we know already before we have seen the definition. Trophoblast plus extraembryonic mesoderm. As villi arises from this chorion, so called as chorionic villi. So very simply, the villi are getting formed from the chorion, and chorion is nothing but the trophoblast of extraembryonic mesoderm. That's why they are labeled as chorionic villi, and they become an important part of the developing placenta. Chorionic villi first form all over the trophoblast and grow into the surrounding basidium. But chorionic villi on basidium capsules are temporary. They are there for some time only. That's why it is called as temporary. They get disappear later on. So basidium capsularis chorion becomes smooth called as chorion nevi. Once they get disappear, so basidium capsularis chorion becomes smooth. That is called as chorion nevi. Chorionic villi growing into the basidium basalis enlarges, but this is the area where placenta has to develop. So the chorionic villi that form on that side, they grow inside, they become enlarged and involved in the formation of placenta. The part of chorion which help to form placenta is called as chorion frondosum. So basically two parts of it, chorion frondosum and chorion nevi. So this is temporary part here, villi, they get disappear later on, we call chorion nevi. Opposite to it, where the placenta gets formed, we call chorion frondosum. With the help of diagram, you can see here. So from the chorion, all these villi, finger-like processes develop going into the vesiculum. So initially they are from all around. Later on, in this capsularis, this villi get disappear. We call chorion leaving. Here it becomes plain, it becomes smooth. But villi toward the basal is they grow inside the vesiculum and they are called as chorion frondosa. So they are enlarging and proceeding further. Right? So this area is the formation of placenta. Formation of seen cytotrophoblast. So we have seen coming from the blastocyte, the trophoblast, then cytotrophoblast is formed and then seen cytotrophoblast. Now cells of trophoblast multiply toward the vesicle where the placenta has to be formed. They lose cell boundaries. So one continuous sheet of cytoplasm containing many nuclei, a cell wall is lost. And this continuous, the cytoplasm and nuclei in between, this sheet is called as seen cytotrophoblast. Formation of cytotrophoblast. Cells of the trophoblast here also retain their cell wall and form second layer. Now it is called as cytotrophoblast. Cytotrophoblast rest on extramembranic mesoderm. So all this seen cytotrophoblast, and extramembranic mesoderm took part in formation of chorionic villi. Now we will see how this villi grows in further direction. So initially there is formation of primary villi, then you get secondary villi, then you get tertiary villi. Before that, one should know what is a cytotrophoblast, what is a seen cytotrophoblast, and what is an extramembranic mesoderm there. With the help of diagram, we will see again here. See here in the diagram A, this is a trophoblast. This is extramembranic mesoderm on which it is resting. So if you remember the process, how the extramembranic mesoderm gets formed, so it is nothing but the proliferation of trophoblast inside. Then it forms extramembranic mesoderm. So naturally it is resting on that. And here is the vesicle. In diagram B, what we have seen, how the seen cytotrophoblast get formed. So this trophoblast multiplies. So they proliferate on outer side. They lost their cell nuclei, the cell wall, and only nuclei distributed here and there within the cytoplasm. So continuous seed of this, the proliferated trophoblast here, which lost the cell wall, only nucleus are there. So this continuous seed here will form is called as seen cytotrophoblast. Meanwhile, this trophoblast get converted itself into the cytotrophoblast. You get here extramembranic mesoderm, you get cytotrophoblast, and you get seen cytotrophoblast. If you see diagram C here, there is further stage. What happens here? Small lacunae get formed here in between. Okay. And this smaller lacunae joins with each other later on, and they form later on, they become bigger in size. So, this is seen cytotrophoblast here in between lacunae get formed. This is cytotrophoblast, this extramembranic mesoderm. Now, when they come together, this lacunae, they will form a bigger size lacunae here. So, lacunae enlarges in size, right? And this is a cytotrophoblast, this is extramembranic mesoderm. So what changes occurs here? Outer side, you get first formation of seen cytotrophoblast. Lacunae get formed. Initially they are small. Later on they join together. They form bigger size, the lacunae. And later on, right, we get here cytotrophoblast and extramembranic mesoderm. Now you can see here. This is a uterine blood vessels here. Then this is seen cytotrophoblast. So bigger size lacunae here. And this uterine blood vessels, they opens into this, the bigger lacunae, and this maternal blood is coming here. So from outer side here, uterine blood vessels, they are coming here through the seen cytotrophoblast. They are opening into the this bigger lacunae here, right? So this is another bigger lacunae here. This is a, you can say, seen cytotrophoblast. And below that you get cytotrophoblast. This is extramembranic mesoderm. So in further stages, you can see here, so you get here maternal blood around it, the joins together, and in between that, you are getting the trabeculum. So So if you take the transverse section at this level, you can see here, this is the seen side of the blood, and around that you get maternal blood. Initially it is in the big lacunae. Again, this lacunae joins together. So one stage will come here, you get inner trabeculae, which is seen side of the blood. Around that you get only the maternal blood, which is coming from here, the uterine blood vessels. So basically you get collection of blood here, maternal blood, and within that you get here the seen side of the blood. So these are the stages towards very primary stages in the formation of these different types of villi. Meanwhile, small spaces called lacunae, already we have seen in the diagram, they form in the seen side of the blood, they join and form big spaces in which maternal blood vessel opens and filled by the maternal blood. Remaining part of seen side of the blood is in the form of trabeculae. We have seen this in diagram. So around trabeculae is the maternal blood. Now coming to the here, actually the placenta formation is, we look, formation of primary villi. Now with this all basic knowledge, what is cytotrophoblast, what is extended mesoderm, what is seen cytotrophoblast, one should understand how this primary villi get formed. So cells of cytotrophoblast multiply and go into the trabeculae of seen cytotrophoblast, that is called as primary villi. Nearby villi are separated by intravillous space. And we know that this intravillous space is filled by maternal blood. Formation of secondary villi. So here, it will explain what do you mean by primary villi. So in this, we get in the center cytotrophoblast, and around it, you get the seen cytotrophoblast, and around that, you get the maternal blood. So this is structure of primary villi. Meanwhile, a further change occurs. Later on, we call secondary villi. So what change occurs? Extramembranic, the layer which grows upward, so which is giving the support for the protoplast, seen cytoplast. So this extramembranic mesodermal layer grows inside the primary villi. So innermost core, central portion is of extramembranic mesoderm, then cytotrophoblast layer, and then outer seen cytotrophoblast. So there is entry of this extramembranic mesoderm into that primary villi, then we recognize that villi as a secondary villi. So only change is that extramembranic mesoderm is going inside it. Then naturally extramembranic mesoderm is internal for the core part, then outer side you get seen cytotrophoblast, then you get seen cytotrophoblast and maternal blood. Then the third change occurs there, that is formation of tertiary villi. So meanwhile, fetal blood vessels grows inside the secondary villi. So once the extramembranic mesoderm goes inside, fetal blood vessels develop, they also enter into that. And once the fetal blood vessels enter into that, this is called as tertiary villi. So in the central portion, you get fetal blood vessels. Then around that, you get extramembranic mesoderm. Around that, you get cytotrophoblast. Then you get seen cytotrophoblast. And around that, you get maternal blood vessels. So many layers get formed here. So innermost, you get fetal blood vessels. And outermost, you get the maternal blood vessels. So in this way, blood transfer through this, all these layers, and this is the, nothing but the placental barrier. And at this stage, these fingerless processes with all the structure we call as tertiary villi. So fetal blood circulate through villi and maternal blood in the intervillous spaces. So maternal blood comes into the intervillous spaces, and fetal blood vessels, they have their fetal blood, and then transfusion takes place through these different layers, what we recognize them as a placental barrier. So with the help of diagram, you can see here what is the primary villi. So this diagram you have seen, these are the bigger lacunes, right? These are the seen cytotrophoblast, and this is the cytotrophoblast. Now cytotrophoblast grows upward, proliferate upward in this trabeculae. So if you take a section here, you can see this is a cytotrophoblast. Then you get your seen cytotrophoblast, and outer side you get maternal blood. So this is the primary villus. Since primary villus, what is the central portion? It is nothing but the cytotrophoblast. Outer side is the seen cytotrophoblast, and most outer is the maternal blood. When you see here the extramembranic mesoderm, this violet color structure, it grows upward in between this still cytoproboblast left, then here it is referred as secondary villi. So if you see in the center, what you get additional layer is this growing of extramural mesoderm. So it comes here, then you get cytoproboblast, then you get seen cytoproboblast, then you get maternal blood into the intervillar spaces. So this is one villi, this is second villi. So in between the two villi, there is an intervillar space. In this intervillar space is filled by maternal blood. So at this stage, we call as a secondary villi. If you take a section of this level, transverse, what you can see in this section? So you can compare with this one primary villi, and you can notify the change. Right? In the central portion, this is extramural mesoderm. Then you are getting, this is a cytoproboblast, this is a seen cytoproboblast, and this is a maternal blood. So this is a nothing but a secondary villi. So in primary villi and secondary villi, what is the difference? In secondary villi, this extramural mesoderm is coming there, which was absent in case of the primary villi. And in tertiary villi, the fetal blood vessels, the structures all are there, but these fetal blood vessels, they grow inside this, the secondary villi. So what is the layers here? Innermost layer you are getting fetal blood vessels, then you are getting here extramural mesoderm, then you are getting here cytoproboblast, then you are getting here seen cytoproboblast. These are the intervillar spaces in which the maternal blood is going. So fetal blood is here, circulation, maternal blood is coming here. So from maternal blood to the fetal blood, these are all layers that form the placental barrier. If you go from outside, you are getting a seen cytoproboblast, you are getting a cytoproboblast, extramural, the mesoderm, and you are getting the fetal blood vessels here, endothelium of that fetal blood vessels. So there's so many layers that forming as a placental barrier. So it allows certain subjects only to go inside, and certain subjects are not allowed inside. So selective, non-selective process would take place at this level, what we refer as placental barrier. The substances which are useful to the fetus, they are allowed to go transfer through this membrane. The substances which are toxic, they are not allowed to pass through this membrane. So placental barrier plays a very, very important role. So this is the structure of tertiary villi. So we have seen the primary villi, we have seen the secondary villi, where the extramural mesoderm is added here. Why? In tertiary villi, fetal blood vessels are added. So this is the last stage villi. So in the stage of formation of placenta, you are getting primary villi, you are getting secondary villi, and you are getting formation of tertiary villi. Now certain villi, that what we call as anchoring villi. The villi attached between fetal surface, fetus is attached on that side, and maternal surface means the maternal uterus or the maternal side opposite to that fetus, maternal surface. So they are attaching in between these two surfaces, fetal surface and maternal surface, and they are called as anchoring villi. So what are the parts of this anchoring villi? You get stain, that is the main part. Then you get branching and rebranching pattern. So truncus cori and rami cori. Lamina cori, so small branch patterns. The second villi are called as free villi. They lie freely in the intervillar spaces. So one end is free and one end is attached. Such villi are called as free villi. Anchoring villi on both sides, they are attached. So anchoring villi. Now coming to the another topic, that is maternal cotyledons. So placenta gets subdivided into number of lobes where the septa growing from maternal side. So from maternal side, one septa comes and it grows inside this developing placenta. Each such lobe is called a maternal cotyledon. They are around 15 to 20 in number. Each cotyledon consists number of the anchoring villi. What we have seen the structure of anchoring villi. One such anchoring villus and its branches called a fetal cotyledon. So therefore, diagram is here. This is a fetal surface from where the umbilical arteries. Okay? So they are coming here. So umbilical cord is there, and fetal surface is there. This is anchoring villi. So from fetal surface to the maternal surface, they are attaching here. So here you get the main stem of that anchoring villi. Then you get branching pattern here, right? Ramus cori. Then you get lamellar cori, small branching pattern. And then they are attaching to the maternal surface. In between this this area is called as intervillous space. So in intervillous space, from maternal side, maternal blood will come and circulate. Right? From fetal side, the fetal blood vessels will come through this. The villi, tertiary villi, they are circulating here. So in between the fetal blood vessels and maternal blood vessels, you get placental barrier here. All the structures are together, this is a placenta, and that you get various villi. So these are the free villi, intervillous spaces. These are the free villi, these are the entering villi. So from this side, they are attached. These are the freely moving within intervillous spaces. So these are the free villi, entering villi, different parts of the villi, entering villi we have seen. Okay? So in this way, in the intervillous space, maternal blood will be there. And in this, within the villi, okay, the fetal blood will circulate. And then there is a transfusion of important things, exchange between mother and this fetus. This is the outer surface, right? We can see the various cotyledons. So what we have seen is the membrane which is coming from maternal side, it grows into the placenta, and this placenta is divided into smaller lobules. So you can see the smaller lobules which are called as cotyledons. They are 15 to 20 in number. Now you are seeing this from outer side. It is very, very important because after the delivery, the fetus is coming out, then we are cutting umbilical cord. An umbilical cord is attached to this placenta. This cotyledons is helpful for the gynecologist because everything has to come out. Placenta has to come completely outside. And this is in the form of this small lobules, what we call as cotyledons. If some part is remaining, right, it is attaching inside only. So you can see gap here. So if you observe the outer surface of placenta, so if you are seeing it is smooth, complete, all cotyledons are there, that means nothing is remaining inside. Because this much part, right, is a gap here, and this much part is remaining attached to the inside of the uterus of the mother. So that may be infective later on, which can create complication. So in this way, cotyledons are very, very useful. And we have to observe the outer surface of placenta for the cotyledons. See the numbers, all cotyledons coming outside or not. That is very useful. Full term placenta, 6 to 8 inches in diameter. Weight is around 500 grams. After birth, placenta along with deciduous is set up, which is coming out. Umbilical cord is attached to the fetal side. It is about 0.5 meter in length. This is the complete length, 0.5 meter and 2 centimeter in diameter. Normal site of placenta function is upper uterine segment. Because during pregnancy, uterus will divide into the two parts. So upper uterine segment and lower uterine segment. So normally placenta forms in upper uterine segment. Placental membrane or placental barrier, already we have described. Right? So what are the layers in placental barrier? From inside to outside, endothelium of the fetal blood vessels, surrounding mesoderm, extramuranic mesoderm, cytotrophoblast, and thin cytotrophoblast. Then you are getting maternal blood here. So these all layers, four layers, they are forming placental barrier or placental membrane. Short note can come as a placental barrier. That time you have to write all these layers for their form and its importance. Coming to the functions of the placenta, it has very important function, nutritive function, then transfer of the waste products and carbon dioxide from fetus to mother. The endocrine functions, immune functions, then it acts as a blood reservoir, acts as a placental barrier. So nutrition, the first function, it transfer the nutrients and oxygen from mother to fetus. So from fetus to mother, it transfers waste products and carbon dioxide, which is not useful for the developing baby. The endocrine functions, it secretes certain hormones, secreted by the cytotoxin, cytotrophoblast of the chorionic villi, very important during the pregnancy. So hormones which are secreted by the cytotrophoblast, which is secreted in nature, that is important during pregnancy. They are like human chorionic gonadotropin. So this hormone is secreted by the cytotrophoblast, which is also useful for detection of pregnancy test. Then human placental lactogen, that is also hormone secreted by this cytotrophoblast. Then estrogen and progesterone. So this is the function of the placenta to secrete the various hormones. Immune function, like IgG, like antibodies pass through the human placenta, providing protection to the fetus. Blood reservoir, the placenta acts as a reservoir of the blood. Whenever there is condition like hypotension, then this blood is utilized from placenta to the fetus, or vice versa. When it is excessive in fetus, so it removes and it stores in the placenta. So it acts as a blood reservoir, acts as a placental barrier. We see the placental membranes, so it acts as a placental barrier. Coming to the, what are the various anomalies of the placenta? They're depending on site, so where the placenta is attached, but depending on the shape, so there are various names for it. We'll see one by one. So depending on site, it is called as placenta previa. Where placenta attachment is in lower uterine segment, normally it is in upper segment, but when it is attached in the lower uterine segment, that time it is called as placenta previa. Then depending on how much it is coming to the lower segment, we call first degree, second degree, third degree, and fourth degree. We'll see the diagram right after this slide. Then depending on shape, we call bidiscoidal. So it consists of two lobes. So placenta is in the form of two lobes. When it is multiple lobes, it is called as lobed placenta or many lobes. When there are no lobes, then it is a diffuse. So placenta is thin and has no shape of the disc. It is the diffuse. Placenta subcentureta is a such condition, small part of the placenta is separated from the main placenta. So it is along with a small lobule, and such type of placenta is called as placenta subcentureta. Then when there are multiple holes within it, openings, it is called as fenestrated placenta. Then one condition is like circumvallic, where the peripheral edges of the placenta circulated by the decidium. Decidium overlaps over that placenta circularly, so that is called as circumvallic. When we look at the diagram, you see here, first is placenta previa. So what we have defined, when the placenta normally get attached in the upper uterine segment, but when it comes to the lower uterine segment here, okay, you can see here, this is the first degree, small part coming and closing to the lower uterine segment. Here, it is the second degree, almost it is covering this lower uterine segment. This is the upper uterine segment. Then in third degree, it is overlapping one internal os, which is not here. Okay? Still, it is up to here. When it covers the internal os, then it is third degree. When completely placenta at this head, the internal os, then it is called as fourth degree. And this is very, very dangerous. As you move from this, the upper uterine segment to the lower uterine segment, it becomes dangerous as you come down. So there is very less chance to maintain the pregnancy. So placenta should be normally in upper uterine segment here. Then here fetus, baby, all that. So placenta will remain on one side. Fetus will come outside first. If placenta is coming here, there is more chance that cervix will dilate and placenta will come outside. So there is lack of nutrition and such pregnancy get terminated. Okay. This bilobed placenta, you can see the two lobes of the placenta. Here, multiple lobes, you can see here, this is a diffuse placenta, no lobes and all that, it is thin, okay? So diffuse placenta. When one small lobe is detached from it, okay? Separated from it, so this big rest of the placenta and small lobe coming here, okay? Which has skin attachment here, so this is called as placenta subcentureta. You can see fenestrated placenta, you can see holes within the placenta, and this is called a circumvallative. This placenta is here. This decidua is overlapping over it peripherally at the margin. So such type of placenta is called a circumvallative. So these are the various anomalies in the placenta. Then depending on the attachment of umbilical cord, we have seen depending on shape, we have seen it where it is attached. And depending on umbilical cord attachment, there are various anomalies. So one type is called as marginal or battled placenta. Is that umbilical cord is at margin. Then furcated placenta, blood vessels divide before attachment. So they multiply first and then attach to the placenta. So furcated placenta, then velamentous means blood vessels ramify and attach to the embryo before going to the placenta. Adramnios, excessive amniotic fluid, that time it is called as adramnios placenta. Oligamnios means less amniotic fluid is there. So either excess or less, depending on that, this animal is there. If we have a diagram, we'll see. So normally, umbilical cord is attached to the placenta at center. When it's peripherally here, right, in this anomaly, the umbilical cord is peripherally, that time it is called as battled placenta. Here, before attaching to the placenta, blastocysts get bifurcated here, multiply here, ramify. Then they're attaching there. So here, they're attaching to the placenta. Before that, they're attaching to the amnion here, and then coming to the placenta here. So these are the various anomalies depending on the attachment of umbilical cord to the placenta. What are the abnormal sites of implantations? Normally, we have seen implantation takes place in posterior superior part of the uterus, the fundus of the uterus. But if it is not occurring at that place, it is called as ectopic pregnancy or tubal pregnancy, when it is outside the uterine cavity. When it is within the tube, right, uterine tube, tubal pregnancy. When it is going to the abdomen, right, or settling there, it is called as abdominal pregnancy. And implantation ovary sometimes that fertilize the egg over can go and settle into the ovary, and that is called as the implantation in ovary. So all these are not suitable, so they will continue for certain time, later on they get terminated. There are the various sites here. Normally you can see here, right, and the rest of the structures here, they are means they are not normal implantation sites. When they are going here, abdominal means ectopic pregnancy, this is ovarian pregnancy, tubal pregnancy here, right? So within this tube. This is a normal one, right? Even this is not normal, they are not going to continue full-term pregnancy. So they are anomalous pregnancy, ectopic pregnancy, abnormal pregnancy. Coming to know that we have two parts which are called as fetal membranes. We'll focus on that. One is amnion, one is chorion. And then we'll focus on the cavities. Amniotic cavity, yolk sac cavity, extramural cavity, and uterine cavity. With the help of diagram, right, we'll see all this, what changes occurs in this pain. Right, so remember that fetal membranes, amnion, chorion, and these are the various cavities. How they compensate with each other till the end. So in this diagram, right, we can see here, okay, so this is the developing embryo here, this is the placenta, okay. So this is amniotic cavity, if you're going from inside, this is a yolk sac. Okay. Then here, you can see, this is extramuranic cilium. Then these are the amnion and chorion. Okay. So these are the fetal membranes there. So chorion is here. Okay. Then you can see here, this is the uterine cavity. So cavities with fetal membranes, you can see here. So cavities like within the uterus, uterine cavity. Then you get here, right, this is the extramuranic cilium. Then you are getting here amniotic cavity, this is yolk sac cavity, this is developing embryo. This is connecting stalk later on from the umbilical cord. This is your placenta here, right? And this is basilar, basalis, where the placenta get formed, right? So these are the now this basilar, this is parietalis, this capsular is here, right? Basilar, basalis, three parts of the basilar we have seen. Right? So the next diagram here, right? Then you can see amniotic cavity, right? So it is expanded, so amniotic membrane is coming here. So this is amnion, this is chorion, and this is extramuranic mesoderm, right? So this together, right, they're joining with each other. You can see the uterine cavity. Later on, this extramuranic cilium will disappear, right? And all these fetal membranes, they come together, joined together, and this amniotic cavity expands, right? And yolk sac goes inside, that from the primitive bud. So in this way, changes occurs within the various cavities within the developing embryo. You can see here, this is the end picture. You can see umbilical cord is formed. This is the placenta. Amniotic cavity is completely expanded. This is the developing fetus. Then, right, we are getting here, amnion is pushed outside, extramuranic cilium disappears. Then you are getting chorion, right? And you are getting basilar capsularis, right? And you are getting here, right, basilar parietalis. So all that fused together here to form strong layer outside the developing fetus here. Right? In this way, this is the cervix, external os, internal os. So all these fetal membranes, right, along with the structures, right? So basilar capsularis, basilar parietalis, within that fetal membranes, all the covers around the developing baby. This is amniotic cavity along with amniotic fluid, right? And baby goes expanding, developing within this environment within the amniotic fluid. And these are the areas, right? So cervix get later on dilated. So this fetal membrane, along with this part, it can come out and form a pouch-like structure. When the full growth is there, they are coming, these fetal membranes are coming outside here, and we have to rupture it. So when these fetal membranes get ruptured, amniotic fluid will come outside, and then baby will try to come outside. So expulsion of baby, that is what we are calling a delivery. Later on, this umbilical cord will come outside. We have to cut here, umbilical cord. Then this placenta, after half an hour, we have to pull it out, and we have to see here, it cotyled on surface here, right? This maternal surface of the placenta, completely, it should be smooth. If something is ringing here, right? So it rings inside, it can cause bleeding, and it can cause infection also. That's why this outer surface, we have to watch for the cotyled on. Umbilical cord, we have to remove, placenta will come out, baby will come out, and this fetal membrane along it will come out. So these are the various stages of us during the birth. Coming to the last part, right? So these two terms, conjoined twins and Siamese twins. So you can see here, right? The conjoined twins, right? The various parts, they are joined together and they are single one for that both babies. So here you can see, right? Heart is, right? The same here. The liver is same for them. The heads are different, right? So in this way, right? Certain structures, they become the joint at certain levels, right? And they are acting on the common parts of the developing both babies. Such the babies are not going to complete their life, because in between they will get suffered from some serious problems. They are not able to survive properly. Come to these two types of the twins, dizygotic twins and monozygotic twins. When two separate ovum fertilize, independent, they are independent genetically. So such type of twins are called dizygotic. Means two separate ovums get fertilized by the two sperms here. Monozygotic, when single ovum, right, get fertilized by a single sperm, but it will divide itself. So from single fertilized ovum, so genetically they are same, but they divide in between, right, and they form the two babies there. So they are called as monozygotic twins. So there are two types of dizygotic twins and monozygotic twins. Right? So here you can see, this is a dizygotic twins. So you can see two separate placenta forms because two separate ovums are fertilized. So everything is, we are getting separate here. You can see here monozygotic twins, a single placenta form. Sometimes the partition is there. So genetically they are same, but here they are independent genetically. So here you can see, right? So there is a partition also. So within the one cavity, right? In the cavity, both babies, twins are developing here. So these are the monozygotic and dizygotic twins. This is the development wise, date wise, right? Day wise here, development you can see. On the 8th day, trophoblast differentiate into cytotrophoblast, same cytotrophoblast. On the 9th day, meconium appears in same cytium. So same cytotrophoblast. So these are the various events, right, in the formation of placenta. The 11th day, embryo gets completely implanted in endometrium. On 13th day, primary villi get formed. On 16th day, secondary and tertiary villi are seen. In the second month, villi are seen all around the trophoblast. 4th month, a definitive placenta is formed. In full term, this placenta is shed off. So at the end, placenta is shed off about half an hour after the delivery. So once it's functioning, it has to come out. So here we finish today's lecture. It is extensive, that you can revise it for twice. You see the first half part, right? And then later on again, you can focus, concentrate, write it down separately on the second half. So overall, what we have seen is the development of placenta. There are various stages in that. When we are focused on the fetal membranes, and at the end, we have seen the cavities and fetal membrane compensate, right? Right from first to the birth, what changes are occurring within them. So in this way, and in the placenta also, we have seen the anomalies, various anomalies which are very important. We have the various models of the placenta. So practical point of view, right, we'll show you that model. So once you're able to identify the placenta model, then while we go on, right, the various stages of formation of placenta. Once again, we read this topic, though it's extensive, from the book. You understood it, how the placenta is formed, what are the functions, what are the anomalies, and then what are the fetal membranes, right? And what are the various cavities they are compensating with each other. So these stages are very important to understand the further development processes. So here we stop. Thank you.